Now we'll do turbulence. So now we're going to start with, let's start with vorticity, actually. Let's back up a second. This made, how many of you guys have a pool or grew up with a pool or have been in a pool like ever or, you know, like to swim? You're in Florida, right? Everybody's got pools. I need to go through this video because this is like a 15-minute science outreach video. But what she does is she drags a plate through a pool and you get these little dimples. But the dimples are actually a vortex tube that stretches underneath the water. So I think that this video has a thing. No, this isn't the right one. Gotta look at this one. And I'm going somewhere with this, and it does get turbulent, but this doesn't become turbulent yet.
Check this out. I'm just going to drag this plate through the water in the pool. That's it. But look what forms.
Perfect black circles on the bottom of the pool. And it's so weird. They don't die. They just keep going right next to each other. I sped this footage up because the circles took 3 minutes to cross the pool and didn't seem to be dying out. These got sharper as they went and made it all the way across. So cool. And look.
Okay. Whose principle is at work keeping these things moving across the pool?
Kelvin's.
This is Kelvin's vorticity principle. Very good. So as you drag the pool through, as you drag the plate through the water, you stir up a bunch of vorticity at the edge of the plate. You create vorticity at the edge of the plate. That vorticity is conserved because of Kelvin's vorticity theorem. So the circulation theorem says that vorticity is basically conserved. Remember that? We did it at the beginning, and then we didn't really talk too much about it. But now we're going to talk about it a little bit more. So you have this. So this is a spinning structure. This dot is a rotating structure. And
these got sharper as they went and made it all the way across. So cool. And look closer.
It's really hard to get a pool that still, for what it's worth. But this is a thing you can totally do in your pool, even with the pump on, with it turbulent as hell. You can do this and race them across the...
You can see what's causing them. There are two almost unnoticeable dips in the surface of the water. Why don't they die out? And how do these dark spots form? And why do the dips move together? So many questions.
This is a really very solid video on stuff. But
let me know. So now
I want to show the other companion video because she did this, which is really cool. Okay, so what she does is she drops. So she has this vortex. And it's just half a vortex tube. It's not a whole ring. So if you like blow a smoke ring, I don't know if anybody here smokes. If you blow a smoke ring, that's a whole vorticity dipole. So that's a ring of vorticity that's rolling outwards as it crosses the room as you hit your friends with your smoke rings. Not that I ever did that. This is just half of the dipole, but it's okay. What she's gonna do is she's gonna drop food coloring in it, and I love this. This is my favorite part of the video. The food coloring travels down the vorticity dive.
On one of the simplest but most mesmerizing phenomena I've ever discovered. You drag a plate through the water, creating two dips on the surface, and sunlight shining through will create two crisp black spots on the bottom of the pool that can persist across the...
She doesn't wear...
The red one cut the green one in half. The red one didn't die, but the green...
Is there anything else that I care about? Oh, yeah.
The vortex passed by so that the pole cuts it right in the middle, and I'm hoping that it'll be back on the other side, or it'll split into two vortices.
Aw, it just kills it.
I think there's too much turbulence when there's an asymmetrical...
Just destroys it. So what's going on? So... I wanted to show you this other video because I forgot to show this one before. Did I show this video before? You can tell me. It's kind of small. Is the problem? Can you see that okay? What does that look like? So what does that look like? Waves. It's a wave. But you see that this is Austin, Texas?
It's storm clouds are sped up, right?
It's sped up. This is a city, and this is the atmosphere, and it looks just like the ocean waves, because because the ocean, or the surface of the atmosphere, is a stratified fluid just like the ocean, and it supports waves just like we did a couple of weeks ago. So there are waves crashing over your head like 4 or 5 miles up, just like waves on the ocean. I think that's all the videos that I had for the day. I'll leave that one up there because it's exciting. When you experience turbulence in an airplane, it's because one of these waves breaks, folds over on itself, and breaks just like breakers on the at the beach. And that's what the turbulence is that you're experiencing, is a wave that looks like that that breaks, and you've got to fly through that mush. Let's talk about vortex tubes for a second. So in the video, there's this half of vortex tube, and she puts a little bit of food coloring in it, and it follows along the vortex tube. And you can see that it doesn't disperse, it stays stuck in that vortex tube, because d by dt of the integral of omega dot dA equals zero. And we proved this in class a little while ago. A simpler way to write this is to say that omega times A equals a constant. So the vorticity times the area of that tube is a constant and doesn't change at time. And when you put something on it, it's constrained to be in that tube because it can't leave because of this. So we wrote down an equation for vorticity, d omega dt equals curl of v cross omega. Now this is cool for a lot of reasons. One of the reasons this is cool is if I take omega and I replace it with a magnetic field, I get exactly the same equation. So vorticity and magnetic fields are really tightly related. So you get this equation by taking Navier-Stokes and taking the curl of it. It's relatively painless. And then there's another term that you get that I'm throwing away for the same reasons we threw it away before. If I rewrite this, I can rewrite this as omega times div v minus v div omega plus omega dot grad v minus v dot grad omega. The only reason I can just write that down without screwing it up is because I just did it. But there's a vector identity that turns this into this. It's just a vector identity. Now, everything that we're going to say for the next, until we're done with turbulence, everything is incompressible. And this has a lot of far-reaching consequences that I will forget to talk about from time to time. But namely, div v is zero and density is constant. And the only place for energy to be is in the kinetic energy. And the kinetic energy is just v squared. Maybe there's a half, but v squared is the kinetic energy. There's a one half and a mass. But we can set the rho, we can set the density to be one because it's constant. So I can rescale it however I want. So being incompressible means this term goes away, and div omega, what's that? Whoa, what's omega? Do you remember?
Constant.
Omega is curl of v. So the divergence of that is
zero.
zero, because the divergence of a curl is always zero. So div omega is zero. So we're left with just omega dot grad v and v dot grad omega. This term I'm going to take to the other side, and I'm going to be left with just big D omega with respect to t equals omega dot grad v. Omega dot grad v. So we need to talk about what this means. So now this partial vortex tube is nice and well behaved. It's round, rotates, stays put. If you jump into the pool, none of those become true anymore. If you have turbulence is doggedly chaotic and random. So everything that we're going to do is going to be in a statistical average kind of sense. And not just an average over space, but an average over ensemble. What does that mean? Okay, that means if I do an experiment 500 times, I average all 500 results, the whole process. So say my experiment is I shoot a jet of water into a pool and I see what happens. I do the same thing 500 times and the whole flow, I average those. So we average the whole result of the experiment rather than averaging, if I want to average, say, you know, how long it takes me to get to campus, I'll add up all my positions and divide by add up all my times and divide by the distance, and I get my average position. We're talking about ensemble averages. We're not averaging over one system. We're averaging over a bunch of different systems. That probably didn't make sense because none of you have had StatMech yet. Once you take StatMech, you will get your head around ensemble averages, and I don't really need them very much. We're talking about results that are in an average sense, in the most generic sense of that. So that'll become more clear as I need it. But turbulence is chaotic and random, and so we have to talk about things in a statistical sense. So the vorticity equation. This is just accurate. There's no approximations here. This is true. This is true because I said incompressible. So the other term goes away because of incompressible. So what does this term tell us? This vortex stretching equation tells us something very important. We got to think about it for a second. So we first got to think about what it says. So the equation says d omega dt equals omega dot grad v. So if I have some vortex tube omega, this is like that pool thing that the plate thing that we just saw, or whatever. So, there's another one up here. Where is it? How come I can never find my do the thing that I want you to do? There you go. On the wrong monitor. The backside of a wave. Oh, let me put that up there. The backside of a wave as it breaks. You can see these long strips of vorticity. As the wave crashes over, you had some vorticity, it got stretched, and you get more vorticity. I'll show you that in a second. But this is so, if this isn't obvious what this is, so you're sitting in a pool. Or you're sitting in the ocean, the wave breaks over you. This is the backside of that breaker. And these vortex lines are really incredible. So we talk about lines of vorticity as though they're like coherent things. Hang on to that as long as you can, but at the end of the day, everything that I'm talking about is really a fractal structure, and there are no lines that really make sense as lines. Forget I just said that. Let's talk about lines. So I have some line of vorticity like this, or like what was in the video. What does this say? This is omega dot grad v. This is, I pick a point, I follow omega up here some distance, and I take the difference. I got v2 and I got v1. And so omega dot grad v is going to be v2 minus v1 over delta x. That, as the two things get smaller. Think about it this way. Think about, I am going to rotate my coordinate system, so omega is along x. I rotate everybody else. This is just the x derivative of velocity after I do that rotation. So this omega dot grad is saying, I've got some vortex line. I'm going to go along that vortex line. I'm going to go from one point to another point, and I'm going to ask what the velocity is doing. So are these two points probably moving away from each other, or probably moving towards each other? Think about how much space there is. Think about how many ways you can configure both of these particles. Think about how many ways you could configure the vectors of the velocity vectors. How many of those are pointing away from each other, and how many of those pointing towards each other? So on average, if I go from this point, I'm going to have a larger velocity, because in general, things are moving away from each other statistically, right? So when I move from this point, I'm going to get a positive number. Yeah.
What do you mean by statistically things are moving away from each other?
Well, I shake up I take a box of water and I just stir the crap out of it, and I put two points in it. I put two particles in it. They're probably going to move apart. They might move together for a little bit, but not very likely. Does that make sense? That's what I mean. You're going to have some particles move together, but some particles are going to move apart. More likely, things are going to be moving apart than they are together. Otherwise, the whole thing would be just be contracting to a point. So, in general, things are moving apart. That means, in general, this is going to be a positive derivative, and so this is going to be bigger than zero. So, in general, if I have some random fluid and I've got some vorticity, if I just pick two points, they're probably moving apart. So I'm probably stretching that vortex tube. So that means I'm pulling on this vortex tube in this direction. And that's going to spin up the vortex tube. So when you pull on it, it spins up faster. And as it spins up faster, omega times A is a constant. That means that if d omega... that means if omega goes up, A goes down. That means if d omega dt is positive, dA dt is negative. So d omega dt bigger than zero implies dA dt is smaller than zero. So I have some random turbulent fluid. There's motions in all kinds of directions. It's chaotic. We can't predict it. I have some vorticity, because that's what happens when you have a random fluid and you stir the crap out of it. You generate vorticity. That vorticity tends to stretch out and tends to get smaller. So why does it get smaller when it stretches out? Think about, you remember doing angular momentum conservation in 2048. If you've got an ice skater who's spinning around and they pull their arms in, they spin faster. This is the same process. So we make omega goes up because of this, and A goes down. So things get smaller. Anybody follow that, at least for the most part? We'll come back, yeah.
I'm confused on why the right-hand side translates to delta V over delta X.
Oh, this? Yeah, okay. That's a good question, and I'm glad you asked, because that is a big part of what we're doing. So omega dot grad. Here's omega. some vector. Not straight, not uniform, it's doing stuff. So this is a vector, so I'm gonna dot my vector into my derivative operator. And what that means is I'm gonna be thinking about a derivative along omega, so I'm going up omega. Another way to think about this is pretend that omega, we're gonna rotate our coordinate system, and that's as easy as just rotating the paper or turning your head, so that omega is just omega in the x direction and zero in the other two directions. Then what does omega dot grad turn into? Omega dot grad just turns into omega times d by dx. So omega is along x. This is the derivative along omega. So I'd rotate my head backwards over here, and now this isn't x anymore, this is like 45 degrees, but the same argument applies. Omega dot grad means I'm gonna take two points separated by a distance that's along omega. Because I've dotted omega, and I've projected my derivative operator along omega. Does that make sense? So I've taken this operator, I'm projecting it along omega, but the dot product, that means my derivative just goes along this way, along omega. So I take a point here and a point here, and any derivative, grad is just f of a minus f of b over a minus b as a and b go together, right? So omega dot grad v is just going to be the velocity here minus the velocity here divided by the distance between them, and you send that distance to zero.
But don't you get a factor of omega on the outside?
Omega dot grad is times v. Formally, that'll be, you know, the magnitude of omega times dv dx along omega. So yeah, I probably should have written down an omega somewhere there before. I was just worrying about the geometry part.
Okay.
So yes, you're totally right there. Okay, so vortex tube stretching. Is why turbulence happens. I should have written this like this beforehand. Go backwards in the video, that's what I just explained. So vortex tube stretching. So we know, I'll just do it again real fast. D omega dt is omega dot grad v. V is probably moving apart. So then d omega dt is probably bigger than zero. That means dA dt is less than zero, and things get smaller. That says smaller. Okay, things get smaller. So how much smaller and how fast? So what we want to know is, how much smaller? So I'm going to draw something that if you stick around if you continue your career in astronomy, you will see this show up, because astronomers will put this up from time to time. Other disciplines, like geophysical fluid dynamics guys will put up plots like this. So this is energy as a function of k. This is wave number k. We do everything in spectral space. Not everything. We do a lot of stuff in spectral space because it's nice. So we have a couple of different scales. So if I take if I take a box and I stir it up, I stir it with some large scale motions. So I dump a bunch of energy into the system at large scale. It doesn't stay at large scale. So you know, if you have, say you've got a really large cup of coffee, like enough coffee. So say it's like a gallon. You put a little bit of cream in it and you stir it once, just stir it around the volume. What's going to happen is that that little bit of cream is going to shred into little bits and eventually mix with everything else. So structures, so when you, when you've got energy in a turbulent system, it, you dump it into a large scale, and then it cascades to smaller and smaller and smaller scales until finally you get to the dissipation scale. So there are a couple things that we need to think about. We need to think about the injection scale. This is where are you dumping energy into the system. This bit is called the inertial range, and I'll show you why in a minute. And here, energy just cascades from one scale to another. And then at the bottom, you have small enough things that the molecules start bouncing into each other, and the molecular diffusion takes over. And this is called the dissipation scale. I'm going to talk about what all these are in a second, but this is kind of the cartoon picture that we'd like to think about. You got some large scale where you dump the energy in. It cascades to smaller and smaller and smaller scales, and then eventually gets dissipated by the turbulence. So let's think a minute about the Reynolds number. What's the Reynolds number? Somebody yell.
VL over nu.
That's right, VL over nu. Nu doesn't change, this is a property of the molecules. V and L can change though, so we need to think about how V and L change. So I'm gonna tell you in advance that in this inertial range, the Reynolds number is very large. So we can skip the dissipation part. What does the Reynolds number do again? Let's look. dV dt plus V dot grad V equals minus one over rho. Grad P, I don't really care about that term, plus nu del squared V. What does this term do to the energy? Do you remember from the homework?
Limits it?
Yeah, this is the dissipation. So we had sorted out, so one of the things you did for homework was you dotted velocity into this, and you get an equation that has some stuff in it, but then some other term that is dissipation, and it looks like this term times, it looks like grad squared, but it's the viscosity term. It's where this term goes. This bit is dissipation. This is little molecules rubbing together and eventually just vibrating and turning into heat. This bit is the inertial term, because this is just velocity pushing velocity. So that just means I got a little bit of velocity. It goes over here because it had some velocity. That's this. So this is the gradient of velocity along the velocity. This is the velocity pushing the velocity. Before, we have omega pushing velocity, but this is velocity pushing velocity. This is the inertial term. So what the Reynolds number tells us is the ratio between this inertial term to the dissipation term. So where this is large, we can skip this bit. And where it's small, we can't. We can skip this bit though. So the Reynolds number gives us a ratio of these two things. So in this inertial range, energy does not dissipate. It doesn't leave the system. It just changes from one scale to another. It doesn't leave the system until the Reynolds number gets down around one. So the energy dissipation rate, epsilon, so epsilon is the energy transfer rate, or the energy dissipation rate. It's the rate at which energy leaves a system. So this, in the inertial range, in the dissipation range, this is going to be equal to nu del v squared. This is what we sorted out for homework. We'll put that in quotes because that's not entirely right. But it's something like that.
Is the epsilon just for when energy leaves the system or both when it enters as well?
That's a good question. So epsilon is when it enters and when it leaves and when it changes from one scale to another. So when it moves from large scale to a slightly smaller scale, epsilon is still in effect. So epsilon describes, and that's a really super important question. Epsilon is for every scale of the system. So say I'm in a steady state, which is usually a bad assumption, but we try to make it a good assumption. If I'm in a steady state, then, so just think about your washing machine. Take all the clothes out of the washing machine and just run it empty, full of water, and it just stirs up the water. It's just going to keep stirring up the water and keep stirring up the water and keep stirring up the water, and it's going to generate something like this. You're going to have your energy injection scale. You'll have a energy distributed in a power law, and then you'll have the dissipation scale. But the in a steady state, the same energy transfer rate happens at every wave scale. So the energy transfer rate into the system is the same as the energy transfer rate out of the system because we've assumed that we're in steady state. It's a super important assumption. It means also at every wave number, we have the same energy transfer rate because energy gets dumped in at large scale and gets erased at small scale and has to get to the small scale somehow. So, what is it? Let's think about just the, so on the outer scale, now that's funny because this is really being manipulated by a bunch of different things. So there's my hand that's stirring the turbulence, and that's actually what's driving E dot. And then everything else has to catch up and figure it out to make sure that the energy dissipation rate at the bottom scale works. What does that mean? I'll tell you. I'll explain that more in a second. Let's talk about what the energy dissipation is. So I dump energy in at a certain energy rate. It's going to get dissipated at the same rate. If I change how I'm dumping the energy in, the turbulent structures will change to make the energy dissipation happen properly. It will dissipate more energy if I dump more in by making smaller structures. I'll explain all that in a second. So let's go back to here. What is energy dissipation rate in here? So on the outer scale, so the injection scale, epsilon equals whatever the hurricane, or me stirring. At the dissipation scale, epsilon equals molecular viscosity, or molecular diffusion. And in the inertial range, epsilon equals V cubed over L. I'll show you why that is in like 5 seconds. But the cool thing about a turbulent system is that the molecular diffusion rate is altered by how I stir the turbulence. If I very slowly just kind of stir my soup so that it doesn't splash everywhere, that energy will get dissipated by the turbulence. If I stir real vigorously so I get soup everywhere and water is flying everywhere, that energy will still be dissipated by the molecular viscosity, but the structures that do the dissipation change. So let's talk about just the inertial range for a second. So in the inertial range, energy is not leaving the system and it's not being added to the system. It's just changing from one size scale to another size scale. So how does it do that? So the energy dissipation rate is going to be the energy divided by the time, right? So the energy is V squared. I don't care about the 1/2. I don't care about rho. Energy is just V squared. Time, how long does it take for energy to get transferred from one scale to another. Well, okay. Oh, do I have Da Vinci's picture somewhere? I don't. So we think about velocity at a bunch of different scales. So we have, so this is energy as a function of wave number. I could write velocity as a function of scale L as well. So I've got, if I have my turbulent box, if I look at things at a certain size, I'm going to have a certain velocity at that scale. And it turns out that the time for the energy to transfer from one scale to the next smaller scale is just equal to the time for that vortex line to turn around on itself. So I want to transfer from one size to another. I've got these swirly vortex motions. When one vortex motion turns around on itself, it basically shreds itself. It doesn't last very long. So in a fully turbulent box, nothing really lasts very long. So the time scale is going to be L divided by V. That's the way you get a time scale out of the quantities in question, is I've got a velocity and I've got a length. So the energy dissipation rate is V cubed over L. Now I say dissipation rate, but I really mean transfer rate. So the energy rate in the inertial range is just going to be V cubed over L. What does that mean? And this is a constant. So this being a constant means that so V cubed over L is constant. So that means that V equals L to the 1/3 times epsilon to the 1/3. And this is a constant and this is not. So this means that if I've got a turbulent box and I take two points and I want to ask what the velocity difference between those two points is, it gets bigger as I measure bigger points. Does that make sense? So I have some mess swirling, it's violent. If I pick two points and I ask for the block, now, random two points, this is a random process. So any random two points is going to give you a random answer. So what I mean by the velocity is the statistical average of the velocity at that scale depends on length, like the 1/3. So as things get further apart, the velocity difference between those two things gets bigger. This is how a turbulent works. So this is why if you throw two things into the ocean, say you throw two watermelons into the ocean, they're going to eventually drift apart, and their separation velocity will get bigger as they get further apart because of the turbulence, because of the cascade. So things get smaller. Now, we want to do this in spectral space, so V equals L to the 1/3, epsilon to the 1/3. The energy is V squared, is L to the 2/3, epsilon to the 2/3. We just square that business. And then we take the Fourier transform, and the Fourier transform of a power law is not really well defined, but it is basically the power law minus 1. You get an extra power from the Fourier transform. So L to the 2/3 goes to K to the minus 2/3 minus 1. So the minus 2/3 comes from just flipping K over to get L. And the minus 1 comes from the Fourier transform. And you get that the energy as a function of K should go like K to the minus 5/3 times epsilon to the 2/3. Times some number C, which we hope is a universal constant. It's about 1.5, turns out. So the energy is a function of wave number in a turbulent system, decays like, goes down like k to the minus 5/3. Yeah.
What is C?
C is a constant. We hope it's universal. It's about one half. I did not give you any new information.
True.
That is all the information there is. Is we want this to be true for everything. So I wave my hands a lot, right? There's a lot of hand waving in this. I didn't do anything that isn't in the literature. All of this hand waving is what we got because we can't actually solve this stupid equation. It's a problem. We can't solve this stupid equation because of that thing that I said in the beginning that was totally inscrutable about mixing Fourier modes. So that becomes very difficult. So epsilon, so energy goes like k to the minus 5/3. Now there's this number. Some people are trying to measure this number. Doesn't really matter. The k is what matters. And the energy dissipation rate also matters. So when does this stop? I'm gonna grab the book because I'm not gonna go slow and careful. I'm just gonna write the answer down because I'm almost out of time and we've been listening to me talk for a minute. And I'm gonna screw it up if I don't do it right. Yeah. So So let's think about the Reynolds number again. LV over nu. So now the Reynolds number, if I've got some turbulent box, I've got some, you know, some turbulent system, the Reynolds number is going to be different for different lengths in that turbulent system because I'm going to have different velocities of that turbulent system. So I just said that V is L to the 1/3, right? The other things are there. Well, let's leave the epsilon there. Let's leave epsilon there. I don't care about the constant. So we'll just pretend it's units. So okay, I drop that in here and I'm left with L to the 4/3 over nu. So this goes until I'm left with the dissipation length scale times the velocity dissipation scale over nu. So at some dissipation scale, this is roughly equal to 1, right? So at the bottom of the cascade, at the very smallest scales, the Reynolds number is about 1, and that's going to set the dissipation length and the dissipation velocity, because the product of those two things has to be equal to the viscosity. Make sense? And we know how these behave. They behave like that. So you can show that the outer scale, the ratio of the outer scale to the dissipation scale, is the Reynolds number at the outer scale to the 3/4. The whole reason I have the book is so that I don't write 4/3 there, which I was about to. So the dissipation scale
equals L times the Reynolds number to the minus 3/4.
So this is cool. So what this says is that if I have a box, it's a bathtub, and I got an oar, and I'm stirring up the water in the bathtub, I can stir it hard, my dissipation scale will be big. I stir it harder, my dissipation scale goes down like the Reynolds number that I'm dumping things in. So by what I do at the outer scale, what I do with a large paddle changes how the smallest, tiniest structures behave. So if I stir big, I get big structures, I get big, tiny structures. If I stir really hard, I get much smaller, tiny structures. That's what this tells us. So the behavior of the dissipation changes bit depending on how I inject the energy. We will talk more about all of this. Oh no, I still got like 5 more minutes. Does anybody have any questions about all this? I think that's all I got to say. So there's a reading on this. So it talks about this. And then it talks about a bunch of other math. So there's some math And it talks about, so he goes through all of this. He also talks about the correlation function, which is going to be confusing. We'll talk about it. And it talks about Reynolds decomposition, which is kind of like what we were doing before, where we perturb things. But instead of things being small, they're large, and you'll see where things fail. I think that is all I want to say for the day. Everything else is just going to get confusing. Let's recap real quick. I went through a lot. What do we got there? Okay, so vortex stretching. One upshot from the vorticity equation and the fact that things are random means typically, a line of vorticity is accelerated. Things get spun up by the flow. Because of Kelvin's circulation theorem, things get smaller. And by things, I mean little parcels of fluid. Little parcels of fluid spin up as the flow moves around, and they get smaller as the flow moves around. At the large scale, you inject energy, and then there's an inertial range where energy is not lost or added to the system, but merely changes shape, changes size. And then there's a dissipation scale, which we can show LD goes like the outer size times the Reynolds number to the minus 3/4. So you've got the injection scale, the inertial range, and the dissipation scale. The dissipation scale gets smaller the harder you push on it. Put all this together, and we're left with the energy cascade, E equals K to the minus 5/3. I'm going to talk about all this in more detail, but this is the nickel tour of what we went over. Does anybody have any questions about any of these?
What's K?
What's that?
What's K standing for?
K is wave number.
I also have another question relating to gas dynamics.
Yeah.
For something like a shock tube, here you have one side with lower pressure and the other side higher pressure.
Uh-huh.
What's the difference between particle velocity and fluid velocity?
So if I have, so say, that's a good question, let me think about that. So if I've got, if I have something like a shock tube where I have some explosion on one side and everything gets rammed down the velocity down the tube, then the particle velocity is going to be the flow velocity plus a Brownian component. I'm just going to leave that as Brown. So if the flow is supersonic, then the particle velocity is going to be that flow plus whatever random motion it has from the random thermodynamics. If I have something like water and a wave, if I've got an ocean wave that's traveling this way, a particle velocity just makes these epicycles, but the wave travels. So if you've got a traveling wave, the wave speed and the particle speed are different. But if I have a shock and a large scale flow, the wave speed and the particle speed are basically the same modulo the random component at the molecular level. Does that answer your question?
Slightly.
Okay.
So the wave speed, is that the same thing as the fuse speed?
So here, yeah, so here your velocity is going to be something like e to the I kx minus omega t. So this will be, so the wave velocity and the actual fluid velocity, the fluid velocity and the particle velocity are about the same, but the wave velocity and the fluid velocity are different. Because the wave velocity is going to be omega over k, which can be different from v.
Does this apply to shocks as well?
If you're not oscillating like this and it's just a shock, then it's more, then you don't have the same kind of separation between the wave speed and the particle speed, because you're just pushing everything along. You don't have this oscillating nature. So, if I go back to the beginning and just answer the question that you just asked, if I have a shock tube, what's the fluid velocity versus the particle velocity? They'll be the same. And if I have a wave like this, the fluid velocity and the particle velocity are the same, but the wave velocity might be different. And the thing that you see moving isn't necessarily what the velocity is doing. Does that make sense? Yeah, if that's still confusing, you can feel free to ask that question again. Okay, that is all I got. Please read chapter 8. And I'll see you. It's Thursday, right?
Yeah.
I'll see you Tuesday.